So I'm going to turn it over to Patty Radel, who is the president of the SAISD School Board.
Thank you, Diana. Thank you very much for the opportunity to come and speak. And I know some people in the room have been sleeping and breathing the TRV and the bond, and we thank you for that support. So, you know, when I'm finished formal presentations and questions and answers, fine, but there'd probably be more than one of us that can answer, plus we can help give each other ideas of how to help explain this within our community. So I want to start off with a presentation that was done with the help of a couple of students from Maverick Elementary. They have a film project. They report the daily news and weather at their school. And our person in communications got together with them and put together a presentation on the basics of the bond and the TRV. So Jim, I noticed you were helping with that earlier. If you want to roll that, we appreciate it. Thank you.
Should I do anything to this?
Yeah, we'll turn it off.
Hi, my name is Ariana, and I'm a sixth grader at San Antonio ISD.
And I'm Memphis, and I'm a fifth grader at San Antonio ISD. We're here to tell you about the 2016 bond and tax ratification elections on November the 8th.
And how these proposals would impact students all across our school district.
But first, we'd like you to know something about our district and its important role in shaping the city we are proud to call home. For more than 100 years, SAISD has educated some of San Antonio's finest citizens.
Today, the district is home to nearly 54,000 students and about 7,400 employees, of which more than 3,200 of them are teachers.
As a large school district, we cover 79 square miles. This includes not only the heart of downtown and San Antonio's Central Core, but parts of Olmos Park, Alcalde Heights, and East Bear County as well.
San Antonio ISD is the third largest school district in the county. We're also its oldest. Multi-generations of family members have attended the many schools in SAISD.
We love our schools, but aging and outdated school buildings present challenges.
The district is faced with the need to provide safe and functional school buildings and learning environments that meet 21st century educational standards.
The district also wants to provide more academic programs for students in need of additional instructional support.
Last spring, our Board of Trustees appointed a 16-member Blue Ribbon Task Force of community members to analyze the district's facilities and academic program needs. The task force visited numerous schools and also received briefings from district administration.
On August 1st, they presented their recommendations to the board to pursue a $450 million bond election and to increase the district's maintenance and operations tax rate by 13 cents.
The board agreed to put both proposals on the November 8th ballot, and now it's up to you, our voters.
We are asking that you become an informed voter as you consider the two ballot propositions in November.
Together, they would provide funding toward extensive school building renovations, upgrades for 21st century classrooms, and programs for expanded learning opportunities outside the normal school day.
Let's take a look at each of the proposals, starting at the bottom.
Let's hear from our announcer.
The $450 million bond would fund renovations at 13 schools. That's 7 high schools, 4 middle schools, and 2 elementary schools. These schools were identified as priority 1 schools based on the age of installation of air conditioning systems and the related infrastructure that caused the biggest maintenance problems. All but one were either built or equipped to have air conditioning with funds from the 1968 bond. Those systems are more than 40 years old. These systems are well past their life cycles and routinely malfunction. Extensive renovations would involve replacing the heating and air conditioning, electrical, plumbing, and structural elements, as well as addressing accessibility. It would also include upgrading science labs and expanding other classroom spaces to meet recommended state guidelines, and modifications to the school's front entries to improve security. Now let's take a look at the 13 schools that would receive the major renovations under the Bond 2016 proposal. They are Breckenridge High School, Burbank High School, Edison High School, Fox Tech High School, San Houston High School, Jefferson High School, Lanier High School, Davis Middle School, Irving Middle School, Rogers Middle School, Tafoya Middle School, Bowen Elementary School, and J.T. Breckenridge Elementary School. The renovations would enable the district to provide facilities that are more equitable with what is being offered in neighboring school districts. The second ballot proposition is the Tax Ratification Election, or TRE. School district tax rates in Texas have two parts: the maintenance and operations rate, which pays for day-to-day operations such as salaries, utilities, and supplies, and the debt service tax rate, also known as the interest and sinking tax, which is used to pay down bond debt used to finance school construction and renovations. Those bond funds may not be used for daily operating costs. A tax ratification election is a way for Texas public school districts to generate additional revenue from the state to pay for day-to-day operations through an increase to the maintenance and operations, or MNO, tax rate. Any Texas school district that adopts an MNO tax rate above $1.04 must hold a tax ratification election to provide voters the opportunity to approve or ratify the higher rate. SAISD trustees have voted to set the MNO tax rate at $1.17, up from its current rate of $1.04. If voters approve the 13-cent increase, it would generate an additional estimated $15.6 million in tax revenue, which the state would then more than match with an estimated annual $16.5 million contribution, for a total of $32.1 million. The revenue from the TRE would initially fund two major initiatives: 21st century classrooms and expanded learning opportunities outside the normal school day. Let's start with the first one, about upgrading classrooms to meet today's educational standards. Technology is a key component in 21st century classrooms. The TRE would enable the district to replace old computers with newer models in schools across the district, and to purchase handheld learning devices, interactive whiteboards, and other equipment, providing opportunities for students to develop 21st century skills with college or the workplace. Classrooms would also be enhanced to support the increased technology, with additional data and power access provided, along with other improvements to the classroom environment. And classrooms would be equipped with interactive furniture that facilitates student engagement in collaborative learning. The TRE would also provide additional funds for teacher compensation for after-school and summer programs. These programs would target the approximately 40% of students in need of additional academic support and instruction time beyond the school day. It would also fund expanded extracurricular offerings for students across the district. The goal is for all of the district's 6th through 12th graders to participate in programs such as fine arts, athletics, or ROTC. Let's talk about the estimated tax impact of these proposals. The average taxable value home in SAISD is $70,023. If both proposals pass, the impact to the average homeowner in SAISD would be an initial increase of $7.59 a month in 2016. In 2017, the impact is estimated to be $8.75 a month, which would incrementally go up to $14.59 a month by 2020. Under Texas law, in 2017, the board could adopt an additional $5,000 homestead exemption. If that exemption is enacted, the monthly tax impact for the average homeowner in 2017 would be $2.37 instead of $8.75, and then it would go up incrementally to $7.79 a month by 2020. SAISD property taxes for senior citizens would not be affected by either of the two proposals, as long as a homestead and over 65 exemption application has been filed with the Bexar County Appraisal District, and they have owned the home as of January 1st, 2016. For more information about homestead and over 65 exemptions, you can call 242-2432 or visit www.homestead.gov. bcad.org. The district is committed to remaining good stewards of taxpayer dollars, as seen with SAISD Bond 2010. That bond has been financed by a property tax rate that has, through effective financial management, been consistently lower than what was originally projected.
We invite you to learn more about the two ballot proposals for the November 8th election. Please visit our website at www.saisd.net/bondtre2016.
Election day is November 8th. Early voting runs from October 24th through November 4th.
Two ballot questions, and so I don't forget to say it, they are at the end of the ballot, so when you go to vote, we hope you will get all the way to the end of the ballot, even if you're a one button pusher for a certain party, you will not have voted on these by voting party ticket. So you need to go to the end of the ballot and you'll find these two questions. And in trying to bring these two items to the public, we've found that the bond, of course, is the easier one because people have seen bonds come forward, they've supported bonds, and they've seen the results. And the bond is mainly for the buildings, right? The building improvements. In SAISD, we have 89 campuses. In the last bond, we were able to improve 22 campuses, and in this one there's 13, so you see that that is a lot to go. And our superintendent will tell you the people that we've heard complain the most are the campuses that didn't get into the bond because they know how bad the schools are. But we have to say, but you know what, it's not as bad as this one over here. The schools that we have in this bond have not received any benefits of a bond since, except for one of them, since 1968. And some of our systems within the schools are so bad, like the heating and air conditioning, that they don't make the parts that we need anymore, and we have to manufacture our own parts and hope that they work, and if not, go back to the machinery department and try again. So there really are challenges. You saw some of the very worn out infrastructure in these films, and that can be repeated through the SC. I have to say, when you go into our schools, like JT is on the list, JT Brackenridge, you go in that school, to me it looks beautiful. We do a pretty good job of keeping it clean and polished and shiny, but air conditioning is a real challenge, as heating consistent, environmental systems within the school are a challenge. So the bond is easier. The TRV is not the easy piece to explain. And we've actually talked about doing a TRV, about 3 years ago. But by the time we were having heavy discussions on it, it was already into August, and you have to vote on doing it in August. And it's taken us so long as board members and administration to understand this, we can't expect that we're gonna go out to the public so quickly and expect them to get behind it. So we didn't do it then, but we brought it up, and we brought it up with discussion for many months now. It's been in discussion. We're all trying to get solid on understanding it. But it is one that gives us a little bit more freedom, because we can put it into programs. We can put it into hiring teachers to do tutoring after school. We can expand programming. So this is sort of like the academics piece. And it's continuous. That $32 million will be every year. So it will make a tremendous impact on what we're trying to do. Again, if you're familiar with SAISD's summer program, as an example, the last couple of years we've only had it like for 5 or 7 days, and it's been used to help children pass a test that they didn't pass during the school year so that they can retake it, as opposed to enrichment. And students that want to get ahead, they want to get their algebra out of the way, or they want to, go on to something that they're really interested in and pursue that a little bit more during the summer. So hopefully we can do those kind of things, plus just help children who have really struggled with reading and they're in the fifth grade and they're still at a third grade reading level, and you know, helping them to catch up. So much that we can do with the TRE related to academics that you cannot do with BOND, and it's just tremendously needed. Many, or I could say most of our students very often enter school 2 years behind what children in a more middle-class environment may enter. One of the things is related to the lack of vocabulary that they enter school with. And so research has shown, and the superintendent and some of the staff and I were at a seminar at Harvard this summer, and one of the things that they presented, some information that some people here already know, but it was a nice affirmation to say that we have to do more for the students on the other side of the school bell. You know, we need to do to present more programs and more opportunities. I taught at JT Brackenridge for about 12 years, and I know the children there were not taking off to ballet classes after school. You know, they weren't going off to the soccer club after school. They weren't going to the Grand Canyon during the summer. You know, there's so many things that the kids do not get to experience. And field trips are an important thing to expand their world. So many of our students are always within a few blocks. The TRE gives us the opportunity to expand those kind of experiences. And yes, it is hard on a ballot to put the word tax and raise in the same sentence and expect people to be enthused about it. But I have to tell you, we have gotten tremendous support from the businesses who are desperate to have students ready to enter their businesses and be effective. They're anxious, they want to hire San Antonians, but you've heard that even Toyota has had a challenge finding people in the city prepared for what they need. And we've had tremendous support from grassroots organizations knocking on doors, and that's greatly appreciated. So we feel hopeful. But I think one of our biggest challenges right now is just making people aware that these are on the ballot and helping with that explanation of what the TRE is. So, go ahead. Rather my reminder on things that could make
sense. There's a lot of things. Yeah. The one thing in particular, too, one of the things that really got you all to that point was what happened with the lawsuit and how the taxes get distributed through the state.
So you all know that the school districts, I think SAISD was the first one to step up and say, we're ready to sue the state because of the lack of education funds coming to the school district. So many districts were involved in that suit, and we felt good because we won at the lower court. Then the state takes that for an appeal to the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court says, well, you're right, the formulas they use for giving money to the school are wrong. They're old, haven't been improved in 10 years. You're right, the state does not give enough schools for the money to the schools for the needs that they have. But we're the Supreme Court, and that's not our business to tell the state in this incident, in this situation, what to do, because they're not doing anything illegal. So they just left it so the state can handle things the way they've been handling it. So what does that leave us with? Because the state isn't stepping up and taking care of our kids, are we going to abandon the kids? These are our kids. We need to do something about it. And the way we can do something about it is through the bond and through the TRE. The TRE is what makes a difference. And as you saw, if we do raise the taxes, the state will match us and more than double what we would be getting from the citizens. So that's an extremely important opportunity, and it's the opportunity that only comes to the poorer districts. Any district can't apply for the TRE, but because of the poverty in our district, we can. And then you also heard it mentioned that afterwards, and if this passes, our board is considering raising the amount of homestead exemption so that those taxes can actually come down a bit. And then
the only other thing you've already mentioned about the business, the fact that two-thirds comes from...
Yes, two-thirds of the taxes that will be raised will be from the businesses. That's why I was so amazed and happy that the Chambers of Commerce have really come out strong with statements and resolutions in support of what we're doing. It's been a real blessing. Yes,
Patty? We know a lot of the parents are working two jobs. There's a part about after-school programs that's going to be enhanced, too.
That's right. The after-school programs, as I mentioned, you know, doing things on the other side of the school bell after 3 o'clock or 4:30 in the case of high schools, doing more club activities, expanding some of the programs that we have that we can, you know, instead of having this many kids in a choir, maybe you can have, you know, so many more, you can hire another teacher. So it will expand, the money we'll have available for tutoring after school as well as added programs. Yeah.
Ask you about the 2010 bond. Did it achieve its goals? I mean, was it financially effective, or was there a lot of cost overruns?
Thank you for giving me the chance to say yes. It's very successful. All of the projects were done on time, and it all came in under budget. The only exception is that with Highlands, that's going to keep going at least to the end of this year, perhaps a little bit into next year. But that's because a decision was made, because there's some other money that became available to actually redo the entire school. So that took us beyond that timeline.
The children did a beautiful job putting this together.
Did they do well?
Yes, they did very well. And I noticed that it would cover band, there were pictures of the band. That's a very expensive program for the families. Usually schools don't cover that.
It is. And even for, you know, those band uniforms, of course the district provides them, but there are other things that come in, like just if you have to go out of town to, you know, to a competition, what that might do for the parents and their, in our neighborhoods, in so many of our neighborhoods, anything that throws off the budget is a catastrophe. We have so many people on fixed incomes, so it is a challenge. I even had one of my neighbors stop me because their son's going to the Young Men's Leadership Academy, and he loves it, but they had to get an extra shirt for something, you know, and he was worried about the challenge of being, you know, need to buy an extra shirt for whatever it was, a club or whatever. So again, you know, all of those things that kind of limit us and what we can offer the kids, you know, we can have a great impact with the TRE. Yes.
I put a notice about this meeting on Neighborhood Next Door from the Dell View.
Thank you.
And one of the questions that I just read was about, well, how serious is the possibility of, if the schools don't improve, that, I hadn't heard this, that charter schools would come in and take over. So how do I answer that? Because I don't know.
Okay. Well, if schools get rated improvement needed for so many years and they show no signs of real improvement, the state can come in and reconstitute the school, tell us we have to do this or that, or they could send in their staff people like you've seen done in a district south of us. But a lot of the things in regards to a school not performing well enough relate kind of individually, you know, and we already have our eye on those campuses that are not performing well. Our new superintendent has been aggressive about doing things to improve those schools. This year, we have 29 new principals at our schools. We have, unfortunately, been satisfied with too little. Our expectancies have not been high enough. And he has good experience in knowing what needs to be expected. So we had a lot of principal changes. We've had some vice principal changes. And of course, we have some wonderful, wonderful talent in the district. So we're making sure that really good talent is getting in the right place. And we're making enough changes that the state has to say,
Okay, they've been in IR for a couple of years, but they just made these changes. We're taking a look at them. We're not going to rush in and reconstitute them. And so some of these major changes are what's happening in order to take care of that. But it is true that at some point, if you don't improve, the state will step in on you. And now how that affects the charters, it kind of depends on what people who serve in the state, what their philosophies are, and whether or not they're big charter advocates, and whether or not they're, you know, big public, traditional public education advocates. And a lot of it, whatever direction it goes, comes out of a real concern for the students, right? In some situations with the charters, people are concerned that, is it just a business, you know? Or is it a real commitment to education, real commitment to the students? And could you, speaking to the state, could you take a look overall what happens to our campuses when you throw in another charter school? I went to speak at the state this past spring because of a charter high school they were announcing that was going to be put up in the Lanier area. Well, we just spent $34 million at Lanier with this last bond to put the career and technology building and to make other improvements. And so the state is going to give permit for another high school to move in right close to us and drain students from our campus when all of this stuff has been done for their benefit. You know, so my appeal to them was to please make it a point to consider the geography of the presence of different schools in an area before they give a permit. And their public meeting to have people review it, review the possibility, was on Southwest Military. And if you know the geography of our neighborhood, that's, you know, you might as well be in Colotus or some other place. It's not our neighborhood. And they were using the evidence of those people down there that said, yeah, bring us the high school, to the people in the Lanier neighborhood who, you know, have a very, very strong dedication to, you know, to that high school and to that community, and that they would review that as invasive, I feel. So it's, where are people at on this, and where are they at on understanding the impact of charters just coming in? Even though it sounds like it's a really good idea. Kip just opened a high school not too far from Lanier, but we have a lot of respect for Kip, and I love what our superintendent says. Anyone who's doing well for our students, we need to feel good about. You know, if they're doing well for our students, we should all celebrate, you know. But we do need to be careful about, you know, draining each other's resources and draining each other's money and draining the capacity out of the facilities that we build. So it's not a matter of your school better do well or we'll bring in a charter. That's kind of a quick view of maybe one scenario, but it's a lot more complicated than that. Hope I didn't kill you too much. What's that?
Patty doesn't like to brag a lot. $37 million.
Oh, well, maybe some of you have heard of that report. We got a wonderful grant through the federal government to be able to create a resource of teachers that have master's degrees, so that we can improve our ability to offer more dual credit. So this grant will enable us to have teachers in training actually be resident teachers at a school while they're in training and going to school at the same time to get guidance, to be mentored, and to within 2 years get their master's degree. And so then they would be filtered out to other schools. We want to get our students as much as possible to graduate from high school with a license or a certificate or even an associate's degree. And we can't do that if we don't have the teachers that are prepared to teach the courses to get them the dual credit, the advanced placement, and all that. This last year, I think it was about 80% of the students
graduating from Travis, I believe, graduated with already prepared with an associate's degree. And so it made the difference. That's one of our early college high schools, so we had a concentration of attention there. But we could be doing that sort of thing in all our schools. Yes?
I think one of the best taxes we ever had was the Alamo Dome, and you know, the tax was added on, and then after a few years, it was done, paid off, and it went away. I'm looking everywhere to see when this is going to go away. Is that, or if it's not going to go away, why not?
You mean with the TRE?
Forever? Yeah.
The TRE is a forever.
And why is it paid off at some point?
Well, it's a continued resource, just like your taxes.
Okay.
Your taxes don't go away, so it's part of the base of the property taxes.
So the bond, does that go away then since you separated them?
The bond does go away. It gets paid off, all the money that we got for that. But the TRE will continue. And the good deal about that is if you understand Texas and the school system and the property taxes, the taxes, when your taxes go up, the state actually grabs that and redistributes it. So we here in San Antonio are paying perhaps for the teacher in Lytle, Texas, if they don't have enough money. You know what I mean? It gets redistributed for use. But through the TRE, that money comes directly to us. So we get to have that ourselves. So that's a big thing.
And so the matching will continue forever as well?
Yes, yes. Okay. Well, yeah, hopefully they don't change anything. We all just have to hold our breath when the legislature's in session, you know, see what else is going to happen to us. So.
Is the San Antonio district heavy with homeowners over 65?
I would say certainly within the inner city areas, yes, we have a lot of homeowners over 65.
They're exempt.
They're exempt. And I know that there are people who's in our district whose homes are considerably more than the 70,000 average. But if we have people with houses that are worth 250 or 300,000, and we come down to an average of 70,000, you can imagine how many people have homes that are worth so much less than $70,000. And you know, so it's
the word is out that there's more bang for your buck over there.
There's more
like at the Highland Park area.
Mm-hmm. Yes, the Highlands District actually has an income that kind of matches the national average or the city average. They're the only ones that come close. Throughout the rest of our district, where the national average of family income is about 52,000, for the rest of our district, it's more like 33,000. And the average family income in my neighborhood, where J.T. Brackenridge is located, is around 17,000. And the same thing with Sarah King. Theirs is the lowest. Theirs is also 17,000 and some change. Yes.
So that figure that you showed that it was 2017, would be like $20. Is that for a house that's worth $70,000? Is that for every home, or is that for just if you had a house that was $140,000, would it be $40 per month that you'd be additional tax?
More. I'm not sure which slide you might be referring to, but if your house is an average of worth $70,000,
yes,
then your annual tax per month would be $7.79, whatever it was. You know, for that amount, and then it will go up a little bit as we approach 2020. But if we do the added homestead exemption of $5,000, then it's going to go down, not the first year, because legally we won't be able to do that, but the second year it would actually go down to less than $3.
Oh, okay.
For a house that's worth $70,000. So for $36 a year, you get a pretty good investment, you know, pretty good return on your investment for our children. Any other questions?
Is there a way that someone not living in the district can help? I've heard of grassroots.
Excellent question. I think that's a good segue to what I wanted to talk about,
okay,
if that's Okay, there we go. So excellent question about how can we get involved in getting out the word, getting out the vote, even if we don't live in the district. I, for one, don't actually live in the district myself. But one of the things we've done here, some of our members have been block walking in the precincts near the church here that are in SAISD. So that's one way we can get the word out. Also, Saria was just talking with me, and some folks are going together to vote as a group, and they can talk about the ballot beforehand so that you know what's on the ballot. If you go to the Bexar County election site, you can actually generate the ballot you will see in the at the polls for your for where you're registered. So I always try to do that. So if you just go to bexar.org, and you can either go to the election site or elections.bexar.org, you can see the ballot that you'll be presented when you go to the polls. Also, to get some of the word out, I know Mary Grace posted information on Nextdoor, and it sounds like Rowena did too. Do you want to just talk a little bit about that, Mary Grace?
Well, I felt like it was important for our neighbors to talk about it, and I knew there would be people who were against it because nobody likes their taxes raised. But I think it gave some of them an opportunity to say that. And it gave me a chance to respond to some of the things they said. And hopefully people, others who are reading it, I mean, some people came back again and were still mad, you know. But hopefully others who were reading it learned more about what was going on.
And Rowena, do you want to say anything about
that? Yeah. The reactions that I've seen so far, several of them say, well, good luck, and you're doing a good job, but that one about the possibility of charter schools coming in and how this bond election might help that, or whether it was, anyway, she brought up, and I think she probably was against the bond, but anyway, that's kind of the reaction I've gotten so far.
I just want to say too, our church is a member of Copson Metro along with 35 other churches, and we're getting out the word in our churches. At our church, we identified all the folks who live, since we're a citywide church, we identified all the folks that live in SAISD, called them, and let them know about the bond. Because a lot of people, I don't think, even have the basic information about what this means to our schools. So I don't know if there's an effort at St. Anthony of Padua to do something like
that. We're not in the school district. I retired from St. Anthony.
School when parents are leaving and handing something out to them, or
if you're willing to do stuff like that, talk to us after. We'll get you set up with everything you need.
Does anyone else have any other ideas they want to share about that?
I can say one thing. I understand that the language for the tax ratification election is prescribed by the state, and it looks real lawyery.
Yeah.
So I don't know whether to say, don't read it, it'll just confuse you. Or read it and look in it for the information that Patty's talked about and that we've talked about here.
I think as much as possible doing the education beforehand is imperative.
Yeah.
Because it is just so legalized, it's crazy. And that's when you see the signs, the little yard signs being put in, all it says is vote for, and it's got a check for TRA and a check for bond. Because, and then when you're meeting with people, you explain what that's all about. But
yeah, if you have somebody look at one of those ballots like was printed in the newspaper today, it's like there's no way you can explain that to them.
Yeah, I know Diego Bernal will say, it's complicated, but just tell the bond is building. The TRA is academics, you know. And, you know.
Just to also mention, because early voting starts tomorrow, an easy thing everybody can do is, even if you don't live in SAISD, most people have some version of a little black book, address book or phone book, right? And especially if you're a retired teacher, if you can think about the amount of people that you know that probably do live in SAISD and make a goal, okay, every day I'm gonna try to call 5 people that I know that probably live in SAISD. That adds up, and you tell family and friends, this is why we support it, right? And we've done that we're doing phone banking in different places. I know the Sisters of Divine Providence had us phone banking training on Thursday, and we're handing them, you know, these commitment cards that we're doing in the parishes, some of the parishes, and they're calling people and teaching them about the TRE and on the bond. So if you had enough information from this, you could do exactly the same thing with your own circle of contacts. If everybody here contacted even 10 people, how many more votes does that end up being, right? So that's another thing to think through and think about.
That's great. And there is a lot of information on the back table. Of course, there is the handout that was, I hope most of you picked up. If not, please pick it up on the way out. COPS Metro also put together what I call a short briefing paper, and this will be up on the website by the end of the day. And it explains really in lay language why we support the bond and TRE, and does actually show what the ballot items will be as well. And I also have some League of Women Voters guides, which has all the early voting sites on it, and also information about all the other candidates that will be on the ballot. So if you didn't sign in when you came in, please do so before you leave today. And again, I'd like to thank you for being here. So.
I love holding on to microphones. One thing to keep in mind too, one thing that we found when we were doing our block walking, there literally have been hundreds and hundreds of votes already cast. The mail-in ballots went out a couple weeks ago, and people are already filling them in and getting them out. And some of the folks we ran into said, oh, I didn't realize that was at the bottom. So those were votes we missed. So it just means I didn't understand what that was about. So it's just the urgency of getting the word out is just really, really important.
All right, well again, I'd like to thank you for being here, and if you have any other questions, I'm sure that Patty would be willing to talk with you. So thank you.